Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals. And by viewers like you.
And welcome to a new season of Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Ed Hathaway. Now, Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dial Teacher standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial Teacher free at 888-986-2345.
Now, you can also send us your comments on our new website at homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your comments. All right, now, before we get started tonight, we'd like to take a few minutes to share a few announcements with you. Now, we have a few new and exciting things going on at Homework Hotline. The first thing is our new website. Mm-hmm. And we just mentioned that, so be sure to go to homeworkhotline.org and see what's new.
Also this year, we Homework Hotline teachers are going to be getting some help from students. They will be helping us here on set, and they'll be hearing on some of our segments on health and careers. You will be meeting them throughout the season.
All right, now the last thing we have to announce is the new prizes for the Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. This year, Homework Hotline will be giving away 3 tablets at the end of the season. We'll also be splitting the Hall of Fame into 3 different age ranges, so one person from each age range will win a tablet. So check out the updated Hall of Fame rules on our website, homeworkhotline.org.
Now, we will get to our first question in just a minute, but it is Thursday, and that means, Mr. Z, you've got a science challenge for us. Huh?
All right, Ed. Now, you were a computer teacher.
I was.
But you were also a math teacher for many years, right?
I was.
So if I
asked you,
how would you find the volume of something? What comes to mind?
Well, it depends on the shape. I see that today we might be working with a prism, so the height, pi r squared.
All right, or we could, or with length times width times height. Anything that's regular like that is pretty easy, right?
Very easy.
All right. Here, I got a sample, and this is something that I bet a lot of our earth science students are doing right now.
All right.
But this is a sample of galena. Gorgeous. This is a mineral.
It's got a little heft to it.
It does. Actually, it's an ore of lead. So this is lead sulfide. It's a pretty pretty heavy. Its density, actually, 7.6 grams per centimeter cubed. I know you're wondering.
Yeah, I never would have known that.
And it's a very shiny mineral. It's actually fairly soft. It's kind of cool, you know.
Very nice.
If I wanted to find the volume of that, that's not going to fit into any
object. Yeah,
that's not going to fit in any of our formulas very easily, is it? Nope. So here's our. It's going to be our question. I want to know, using what I have in front of me. Now, this is just water that I put a little food color in, so it would show up on the TV a little bit. And I have a graduated cylinder. And so our question is, how can I find the volume of that sample of galena?
Very good.
All right.
Again, the science challenge for today is, using what Mr. Zinger just showed us, how can we find the volume of that sample? Now, if you think you can solve the science challenge, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or you can just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
But every correct response will be at our Hotline Hall of Fame. Remember, if you earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season. All right.
Okay.
Time to do some homework.
Let's help out with the homework.
Hello.
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 Hi, who's this?
Tizer.
Hi, Tizer, how are you?
Hi.
Tizer?
Say that again.
Tizer, how you doing?
Good.
And you've got a math question for us?
Yes.
All right, thank you. All right, Tizer.
You got a math question for us?
What's your math question?
5,372.
5,300, wait a minute. 5,372, got it. Go ahead, Tizer.
Times 10.
Okay, you might want to turn off or turn down your television because you're kind of trying to watch the show and talk to me. You might want to turn it down, okay?
Okay.
Tizer?
Turn on the television.
All right, times 10 divided by 2.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a good math problem. I was doing some math today. I want to make sure that my friends from Honeyoy, Brittany and Carl, are watching. Brittany and Carl from Honeyoy, we're going to pick this problem up, and hopefully you'll learn something. All right, Tizer, go ahead. What do you think we should do first in this problem?
Line it up.
Okay, I kind of got things lined up here, left to right. I don't think if that's what you're talking about. Okay, but what do you think we should do first?
Times the ones place, zero times zero.
Well,
two times zero.
Well, I'll give you the multiplication. We are going to do the times first. What we got here, Tara, is what they call an order of operations. So we got two operations. We got multiplication here. Tyra, what else do we have besides multiplication?
Division.
Very good. Very good. And normally the way we would do this is we would do them left to right. And that's the way we will attack this problem. But you would get the same answer in this case if you divided 10 or 2 into 10 and then did the multiplication. But let's do this multiplication first, left to right, like you're reading a book. Terry, do you know how to multiply by 10? How easy it is to multiply by 10?
Yeah, just add a zero.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to hear you say. So I'm going to take this part of the problem, and I'm going to get an answer by simply adding a zero. And then I'll bring down the rest of the problem. Divide by 2. Okay? Take zero. I'm going to put a comma in here. Can you read that number for me? Can you read that number for me?
What number?
Okay, I'm sorry. The number that when we add the zero, it's
53,720.
Right, we're going to divide it by 2. So let's do that. Let's do 53,720 and divide it by 2, okay?
Okay.
Okay, Derek, help me out. How many times will 2 go into 5?
It really won't, because it's not an even number.
Well, you're right. It won't go in evenly, but it will go into it 2 times, won't it? Because what's 2 times 2?
2 times 2 is 4.
Very good. Very good. I'll put a 4 under there, subtract, and bring down my 3. Okay, again, it won't go in evenly, but how many times will 2 go into 13?
2 goes into 13. 4 goes into 13 3 times.
Well, let's try a 6, Tyree. What's 6 times 2?
12.
Okay, I got to have you study your multiplication facts, buddy, before we get into problems like this. Let's subtract 1 and bring down the 7. Okay, now 2 goes into 17 9 times. Tyree, you notice how I'm putting one number above each number in the problem?
Yeah.
Oh, wait. It's eventually going to be 8. 2 times 8 is 16.
Uh-huh.
Subtract another 1. Bring down a 2. Now we're going to get something even. How many times will 2 go into 12? We already did it once.
2 goes into 12.
6 times. All right. And then finally, we got a 0 here. We'll put up our answer, and we get this guy, 26,860. Right, Dave Zero? Thanks for calling.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
Okay.
I said, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, I think we have Truth on the line.
I think we do.
Hi, Truth, are you there?
Yes, I'm
here. Hi, how are you today?
I'm very good, thank you.
Good. Now, what grade are you in?
Excuse me, I didn't hear you.
Oh, so what grade are you in?
Oh, I'm in 8th grade at Joanna Perrin Middle School.
Oh, in Fairport, right?
Right.
Yes.
Oh, great. What kind of question do you have for us?
Actually, I have a science question.
Oh, science question. Right, up your alley, Mr. Z. Perfect.
Right. What's your science question? I hope it's one I know.
Well, I have 2, but my first one is, why do you see lightning before you hear thunder?
I don't know why.
Yeah.
I hope you do.
Well, let's think about it. Lightning, you're seeing lightning, right?
Yes.
Okay. So when you're seeing lightning, that's a flash of light that's actually traveling from where that is to your eye, right? Now, what lightning is, it's an electrical discharge. It's when that charge in the clouds meets the The charge, it meets the ground. Sometimes it comes from the ground up, top down. But basically what happens is that electrical charge is so hot, it heats up the air to actually hotter than the surface of the sun. And that's what we see, wow. Right? Now, do you know what thunder is?
I know what the sound is.
You know what the sound is. And actually what causes
it. Oh, I know too, Joe.
Yeah. What causes that thunder is when we see that lightning. Now, remember, that's, I said it's hotter than the surface of the sun, you know, a small area. But it's that spot is so hot, it makes the air expand really fast, right? Because hot things get bigger.
I can understand that.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And it's that which causes the sounder. It's that air expanding quickly that makes the sound of the thunder. So notice they happen about the same time, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
But, very close.
But there are two different types of waves that are traveling to you. Now, you're seeing it because that's a light wave, okay? And you've heard of the speed of light. Nothing travels faster than the speed of light.
Yes.
Okay. Now, are you using the metric system or are you using miles?
I use miles.
All right. Light travels about 186,000 miles a second.
That's pretty fast, aren't
you? In 1 second, it goes that far.
I didn't know that before.
All right. So that's really fast, right? You turn on light, it happens almost instantaneous, right?
Yeah.
All right. Now, sound is a different type of wave altogether. It's a compressional wave, and that's traveling through the air. They both leave at the same time, but the sound wave travels only about 740 miles in an hour.
That's so it's a lot longer.
That's very fast, right? But,
yeah.
But nothing compared to light. Be like me racing Ed. I'd leave him so far behind
right,
you.
My gosh.
All right.
With my legs, true.
All right. So notice it goes a lot faster, and that's why we see it. There's two different types of energy being transformed there. Okay? Does that make sense? All right, you had a second question?
Yes. Thank you for asking. How do bicycle gears help you pedal faster or slower?
All right, let me go to the board for that one. That's pretty cool. All right. If we've got a bicycle, and now Ed's going to get to laugh at my artwork, okay? All right, so here's our bike, okay? And I'm not going to do too well with the, okay, here's our frame. And all right, back here. And I got a seat. Hey, I should have been an art teacher, huh? Okay, but here's the hard part, getting that. Here's the sprocket in your pedals, right? Now, that's usually only one, sometimes two or three, you know, but it's not as many there. But you got a chain that goes back from there, and then you got another sprocket. There's several sprockets back here, right? Of different sizes that chain goes over?
Okay.
Okay. Now, here's we got a picture. If we've got a big one here and the one back there is smaller, which one's going to be, if every time this goes around, is the small one going around more times or less times?
Less times.
All right. This one's smaller, right? So if the big one's turning the small one, it's actually going to make the small one go around more faster than the big one was, Will, right?
Yes, all right. I understand it now.
Yeah, does that kind of make sense? I know I'm not explaining it well, and I certainly don't draw very well. But now let's take it the other way. If there was a smaller one here turning a big sprocket back there, this one would have to go around a couple times to turn the big one once, right?
Yes.
All right. So if you have a bigger sprocket on the front and a smaller sprocket on the back, you're going to get more speed when you pedal, right? But you know from riding your bike, is it harder to, or is it easier to pedal when you got the big one and the small one?
I think it's easier.
When you got a big one in the front and you got the small one in the back, you can go faster, but actually it's harder to pedal, all right? If you're going up to a hill, usually you shift down, so sometimes, you know, they're almost the same size, or maybe even the back one could be possibly even a little bit bigger. It gives you more power, but you got to pedal more times for you to move, right?
Okay.
Yep. All right. So you've got a bike with gears?
Yes.
Yeah. When you're trying to go up a hill, you usually downshift, right? And I don't know if you ever look where your chain's going on your wheels, but it goes to one of these bigger sprockets on the back. You got to pedal more times, but it gives you more power. All right. And that gets into more physics than we need to get into right now. But when you want to go faster, all right, you shift down to one of these smaller ones. So let's say every one time you go around, your wheel goes around twice, right?
Okay.
All right. That's going to make you go faster, but it's harder to do it. You can't get anything for nothing in physics, and so, you know, you can't just get that power automatically from nothing. You've got to put the effort in with your legs. All right?
Okay.
And then it's going to be further changed because now you're turning this, but look how much bigger the wheel is. Okay? But you did a great job. That's a great question. I hope my artwork didn't throw you off, but love those kind of questions. Call more often.
I definitely will. Thank you very much for helping me.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Here's a fun saying to help you remember the basic needs of the human body. Oh, can Venus flies make pretty webs? This actually helps you remember oxygen, carbohydrates, vitamins, fats, minerals, protein, water.
All right, now we'll get back to the phones in just a moment. But first, let's take a look at this week's Hotline Book Reviews. Check them out.
My book is called Moonrise from the Warrior series. The author is Aaron Hunter. This book is about four clans: Thunder Clan, River Clan, Wind Clan, and Shadow Clan. They are made up of wildcats that form territories and live in camps. They believe in a clan that lives in the sky, Star Clan. Star Clan is where the cats go when they die, and the cats also get dreams from them. In this book, four cats are sent a dream from Star Clan. The cats are all from different clans: Brambleclaw, Thunder Clan, Feathertail of River Clan, Crowpaw of Wind Clan, and Tawnypelt of Shadow Clan. The dreams tell them to meet two other cats from, one from River Clan and one from Thunder Clan, heard about the dreams. They also came to the meeting. At the meeting, they talked about how the cat in their dreams had said two legs humans will destroy the forest by making more thunder pads. The cats then met again in private and made up their minds to travel to the sun-drowned place. The two cats who found out about the dreams, Stormfur of River Clan and Squirrelpaw of Thunder Clan, insisted on coming with the four cats. So the six cats all went on a journey. The cats ran into another cat named Purdy, who said he knew where the sun-drowned place was. Turns out he had no idea, but the cat still traveled with him. While the six cats were traveling back at the forest, the destruction has started. The two legs humans are ripping up trees, and they scare all the prey away. The clans are starving, all except River Clan, who are patrolling their borders more than ever. My favorite part is when the cats meet Purdy. When he says he knows where the sun-drowned place is, but he really has no clue. I recommend this book to anyone who wonders what wildcats do in the wild and loves an adventure. If you're interested in the Warrior series, I suggest you start with the first book, Into the Wild.
Hi, my name is Olivia. I'm currently reading the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants series by Anne Bradshares, and have just started the fourth book. But the one that really stood out to me was the first book. Now I'm going to tell you what it's about, and maybe you'll want to read it too. The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants is about four girls: Tibby, Lena, Bridget, and Carmen. All the girls are going somewhere different for the summer, except Tibby, who's staying home for a documentary. The day before the rest of the girls leave, Tibby spots a pair of pants on Carmen's dresser and says, "I want those pants." Tibby likes retro things for some reason, but Carmen doesn't care because she knows that they won't fit Tibby anyway. Tibby tries them on for fun, and all of a sudden they fit her perfectly, as though they were magical. So then Bridget and Lena try on the pants, and again the pants fit both of them perfectly too. They all decide that for the summer, one girl would keep the pants for a week and then mail it to the next girl and keep repeating it for the summer. The next day, Lena heads off to Greece with her younger sister Effie, Carmen is off to see her dad in South Carolina, and Bridget is off to soccer camp in Baja, California. All I can say is that you might be surprised at the end of each girl's crazy summer, but you'll have to find out what happens to the girls and why their summers are so crazy in the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants. I have to warn you, though, you can't just read one of the books. You might end up reading the entire series.
All right, now if you want to see this segment or others like it, you can go to our new website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right.
And I think we have another call.
Back to our problems. Hello.
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 Hi, who's this?
Adewale.
Hi, Adewale. How are you doing?
I'm good.
Yeah,
good.
You've called before, haven't you?
No.
No? Okay, I thought
first
you had.
Time.
Okay.
Adewale, where are you calling from?
Brooklyn.
Uh-oh.
Brooklyn.
That's where the Yankee fans are. I always like to mention those Yankee fans. All right, Adewale, I'm going to go to the board. Let's try to do some. You have a math question, right?
Yeah, it was actually 1, 2, 3. It was 3 math questions.
All right, well, let's do the first one. Okay, Adewale, let's do the first one. What's your first math question?
All right, the question is 7, 7, 3, 5, 6, 7.
Okay, okay. What do we got to do with that number?
We have to write it in words.
Okay, so let's talk about this number first before we write it out in regular English words. Let's talk place values, Adewale. You see this 7 here, the first 7 on the far right? That's in the ones place, correct? You knew that?
Okay, I know.
Okay, how about the 6? What's the place
the
value for
it? The 6 is in the 10th place.
Good, how about the 5?
100.
Very good. The 3? The 3 is in the 1,000th place, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay, and how about the last 7 on the far left? What's the place value of that 7?
Yeah, the 7 is on the 10,000th.
10,000th. Very good. Now, normally, Adewale, we have the comma that separates our different place values. This 7 and 3, like you told me, they're in the 1,000th place. So we would read that as 73,000. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
The 5 is in the 100s, 6 in the 10s, 7's in the 1s. So let's start to write this out. First, we'll do the 1,000s. You told me it was 73. Now, whenever we combine a 10s with the 1s, whenever we combine the 10s with the 1s, we do that. We say it at one place value or one word, usually hyphenated. And then you told me it was 73,000.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, here's where our wordage gets a little bit unique. When we do the thousands, we write out the whole number, then say thousands. If we had a number in the millions, we would say like 52 million. Same thing with billions, 158 billion. But when we get to the last 3 place values, we always read the hundreds separately. So the next thing we would do is we would write 500, as long as not a zero there. Okay, we do not use the word and in this. That's saved for a decimal point. Okay, after the 5, we have a 6 and a 7. So again, we combine those. 67. So in words, that's 73,567. Thanks, Adewale.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
I got another question.
You know what, Adewale? Call Dial a teacher. They'll help you with those last 2, all right? Thank you.
I said, hey.
FOIL, an acronym for the rule for multiplying 2 binomials horizontally. First, outer, inner, vast.
Mr. Z, we've got a winner.
We lost him. So, Ibrahim, you're going to get credit, Ibrahim. We're sorry we lost you on the phone, but so I'll have to talk to you.
All right.
Boy, Ibrahim, I wish you'd been there. All right. Ibrahim correctly said that we've got to put some water in our graduated cylinder.
Okay.
All right. So what we have in there, Ed, is we have 50 milliliters of water
exactly,
right now.
Right. I saw
now,
that earlier.
1 milliliter is the same as 1 centimeter cubed.
Gotcha. Okay. I didn't know that.
All right. And what we're going to do is just by displacement.
All right.
So I have this. I'm going to slide it in there. But here's a couple things to be careful of. First, we have plastic graduated cylinders.
Right.
So these are pretty sturdy. But if you have glass ones, I've seen kids drop it in.
Crack.
The cylinder breaks and you lose everything.
Careful.
The other thing you got to be careful is when you drop it in, you don't want any of this water to splash out because that's going to change your value.
Mm-hmm.
So when you drop it in, turn it sideways, let it slide down carefully.
Yep.
And now we could see the displacement, how much the volume went up, and that would tell us what the volume of this piece of galena was. So this went up about 5. All right, okay. I can't see that well, but so it had a volume about 5 centimeters cubed, about 5 milliliters. We would try to be more accurate if we were doing this for real.
Man, that was well
that's
done.
How we do it.
And
all right.
That's known as displacement.
That's
and
displacement.
Something new there, all that. Okay.
All right. So congratulations, Ibrahim. But don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you win a tablet at the end of the season.
Now, that's all the time we have for tonight. We are going to say goodbye. But remember, Dial-A-Teacher is still available with free homework help on the phones until 7 tonight.
And remember now, tune in on Monday as we continue our series on the artist Albert Paley.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.